are continuing to talk about people in the Bible that surrendered. And tonight we're going to talk about a man by the name of Timothy. Okay, we talked about Saul, who turned to Paul, and now we're talking about Timothy. Let's go in our Bibles to Acts 16, where we first see Timothy. See, I want to live a surrendered life like these people that have gone before me, because in surrender, you complete what you're called to complete. You complete what you're called to complete. Acts 16. You there? Are you there? Good job. Good job. Acts 16. We're talking about Timothy. In surrender, you do what you're called to do. Can you complete God's purpose and plan for your life outside of surrender?
No.
What are we doing right here? What are we doing right here? Can we complete God's plan for our life outside of surrender?
No.
No, we must surrender. Remember, we surrender and then we submit to the Word of God. I'll never submit to the Word of God if I'm not surrendered. I'll just start performing. And guess what? Eventually, after a performance, what comes?
A fall.
Well, pride comes before a fall. But like whenever there's a movie, you go and watch the movie. And then what? What? An end. Okay, have y'all ever seen the credits? Like the credits starts rolling. There will be an end to your performance. And it usually ends in offense. Usually ends in walking away.
Yes.
It usually ends in death, if we're being honest. When you're not surrendered. So if you don't surrender, you don't complete God's call for your life, and then you just perform, you put on, you act, and in that act, guess what? There's always a death or an end. It always ends. Like every movie ends. Is there a movie that just keeps going and going and going and going and going and going and going? No. There's no movie that keeps going and going and going. Well, guess what? What did Jesus say? Like he was the last show. He made a public show, right? And what did he say at the very end? It is
finished.
It's done. So if I don't surrender, then I won't complete or I won't do what God has called me to do. Why is it important for me to do what God's called me to do? It's a will for his life. It's his plan. Michael?
It's perfect and you'll never mess up.
It's perfect. His plan is perfect. But why? Why do I need to do what God's called me to do? Because my choices aren't just about me. They're about him, but what are they going to do? They're going to have an effect on who? Like if I wouldn't have chosen to take my place, like everyone else, right? Everyone else is affected. So I want to do God's call on my life, but that requires me to do what?
Surrender.
Say, I have to surrender.
I have to surrender.
That means I have to completely walk away from all that I represent and walk into all that he represents, which is found in his word and by the Spirit. So I have to surrender. Look to your neighbor and say, you got to surrender. Anything that you continue to hold on to in your life, that will be the very thing that ends up driving you away from his plan. From him and his plan, his provision, his peace, it will drive you away. What you think you need to have control over, you will lose control and it won't end well. So Acts 16, 1 through 2, we'll see where Paul first encountered Timothy. Then he came to Derbe and Lystra. This is Paul. And behold, a certain disciple was there. What does disciple mean?
Follower.
Follower of who?
Jesus.
Follower of Jesus. So a certain disciple was there named
Timothy.
The son of a certain Jewish woman who believed, but his father was Greek. Verse 2. He was well spoken of by the brethren who were at Lystra and Iconium. So number one, he was a disciple. And then he was what? What does it say?
Greek.
No. Sorry, put it back up.
A disciple.
Nope, we put it back up. I apologize. He was well spoken of. Okay, this is Timothy. Say, I must surrender. I want you to think about, what would Paul say of you? What would be told of you, about you, from others? Because see, Timothy, He lived a surrendered life. How do I know he lived a surrendered life? Because number one, everyone knew that he was what? He was a disciple. And then when people were asked, when Paul asked people about him, what was he? He was well spoken of. So would it be said of me, oh yes, they're very attentive in class. They do what they're supposed to do. At church, they're very attentive. At home, they do what they're supposed to do. What would be spoken of me? Because what is spoken of me is a result of my surrender. If I'm not surrendered, will I be well spoken of?
No.
No. Are things said of me, well, they always act up. They're always jacking around. They never pay attention in school. They never do what they're told. You have to tell them what to do over and over again. What is spoken of me? Because Timothy was pulled out by Paul. Why? Because he knew he was a disciple. He followed God. But not just that. Because a lot of people come to church. But what was the second thing? He was what? He was what? He was well spoken of, or well spoken about. So that set Timothy apart. See, surrender will always set you apart and set you up. People that don't surrender, like, there's always bad things happen. Like, it's always like up and down, up and down, up and down. And nobody wants to follow somebody that's all over. Paul wasn't able to pick just everybody out of the group. Whenever he showed up to Derbe and Lystra, he saw Timothy. Why? Because number one, he was a disciple. But number two, he what? He was well spoken of. Like, he had lived his life in a surrendered way. So whether at school, like, his teachers had good things to say about him. His parents had good things to say about him. His friends had good things to say about him. The priests at the temple had good things to say about him. Strangers had good things to say about him. Now, were there probably some kids that didn't like him because he was really good?
Yes.
Probably. But was Paul listening to those people?
No.
No. They don't have an opinion that carries any weight. But so what's said of me? Like, what would my parents say of me? What would my teachers say of me? What would my friends say of me? What would my pastor say? Oh, that kid's always paying attention. They're always, you know, they're ready to receive. They bring their supply. Because here's the thing. Why was Timothy the one chosen?
Because
he was a disciple and he was well spoken of. And if you're going to be a disciple, a true disciple, not just a show up, and if you're going to be well spoken of, then you must live a surrendered life. See, I want it said of me that my life isn't about me, it's about him. I want it said of me, and that's what was said of Timothy. He was well spoken of. His life wasn't about him. And we see that as we go further on, that there was a reason why he did this. He had this surrendered life. Go in your Bibles to 2 Timothy 1. See, if you're going to do what God's called you to do, what do you have to do? You have to surrender. And then submit to the word of God. You cannot keep doing your own plan and get by. You'll walk away. Bet money. If I was a gambler, gambled on people who didn't surrender, from the time I've started being here to the time now, I would have made a lot of money on that gamble. Because the sad thing is believers that just show up, that doesn't mean you're surrendered. Do you understand? That doesn't mean you're surrendered just because you showed up. Now, do you need to show up? Yeah, the word says. That's awesome that you showed up. But you have to live life outside of church in a way that's surrendered. See, Timothy was picked. He was chosen to carry on, to lead these churches, to pastor these churches. He was called to carry on the major anointing that Paul had received. He was called to carry it on. Why was he called? Because he showed up at church?
No.
Because he jacked around during praise?
No, because he was surrendered.
He was surrendered. Y'all, and surrender looks a certain way. Surrender looks a certain way. Surrender says, none of me, all of you. Not my feelings, not my thoughts, not what I want to do. God, what you want to do. Remember what Jesus said in the garden? Not my will, but what?
Your will.
Your will be done. Surrender looks a certain way. And when you surrender, you not only step into your call, you step into grace, provision, protection, peace, joy that's been provided for you. When you're not surrendered, it gets weird. And there's not ever a flow about the flow. Hello, the money, the provision, the peace, the joy. 2 Timothy 1, 5 through 6. Look what it says. Another thing about Timothy. Timothy was surrendered. Say, I will be surrendered. Paul's talking and he says, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned or not fake faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois. So it started with his grandma, and then look what happened. And then your mother Eunice, and now I'm persuaded it's in you also. So Timothy had been given something. Each of you, you are given something. Every time you sit down and read the Bible, you're given a word from God. Every time you come to church, you're given a word from the word in teaching. Every time you put on a message, you're given something. Well, what was Timothy given from Grandma Lewis and then his mom Eunice and then it came to him? It was this faith. It was this message. And it was Timothy's job to hold on to the message and continue to work it into his life. See, whenever you surrender, you drop everything else and you hold on to him. And what did he do? Timothy held on to the faith that he had received, the word of God, the message. What is one word that you've received, Ryan, that you've held on to?
Probably not to be scared.
Not to be scared. God hasn't given me a spirit of fear. What is one word that you've received that you've held on to, Sadie? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Ellis.
Be fair in what you do for yourself
and for others. Be fair in what you do?
Yeah.
What scripture is that? What word is that? I need word. I need gospel, not some inspirational quote. Zaylin. Hopefully it wasn't an inspirational quote. Zariah.
I'm strong in the Lord.
I'm strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Oh, that's a good one. Michael, what word have you held on to? Right, we'll end up eating the fruits thereof. Merritt, what's one word that you've held on to? From the word of God. The Holy Spirit, that's good. You've heard about the Holy Spirit, so you know that there's power in the Holy Spirit. Zay?
10 times smarter.
10 times smarter, right? Because Daniel was 10 times smarter. Bella? Be courageous, be strong, and of good courage. Yes. Faithy. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Major. What?
Not to be fearful.
Not to be fearful. God hasn't given me a spirit of fear. Caden.
I walk by faith and not by sight.
Ellis.
There's power in the tongue.
God has not given me a spirit of fear. So good. What? What?
Do not get out of your seat.
Oh, don't get out of your seat. That's so good. You're seated in heavenly places. Yes. What about you, baby? Yes. What?
Don't stop.
Don't quit. Continue. After you've done all the stand, stand, right? Truly.
What?
Treat others the way you want to be treated. Be kind one to another. Tenderhearted, forgiving one another. Even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. Doodly-doo. Thomas. So that's the word that you hold on to. God has given me a spirit of fear. Liam.
Confidence.
What's a confidence? What's this confidence scripture? What's a scripture about being confident? Be strong in the
Lord.
Be strong in the Lord and the power is might. See, this is the thing. Pipe, you have a word? Oh, well, you're raising your hand, little girl. Put your hand down there. Bae? Huh? I'm healed and whole. Ooh, that's a good one. Erlyn. What? What'd she say, Pilar?
Don't touch other people's stuff.
Don't touch other people's stuff. I don't know what word of the Bible I can pull out of that, but you don't need to touch other people's stuff. Micaiah? Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Titan? As for me and my house, preach, we will serve the Lord. Ken? Be thankful? Faithful. Yes, so good. Elliot? Power and love. God doesn't give me a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. Case? Y'all be quiet. What? Offering, give, and it will be given. Yeah, you got, see, listen, we've all received a word, and you got to hold on to that word. See, Timothy received word from grandma. Wayla passed down a word to mom, and then mom passed down the word to Timothy, and Timothy had to decide, I'm going to hold on to this and not let go. Because whenever I hold on to this, what am I doing? I'm surrendering. I'm saying this is the most valuable thing. The word is the most valuable. So when I hold on to the word, what happens? I'm living a surrendered life because I'm not picking up fear. I'm not picking up insecurity. I'm not picking up pride. Why? Because I'm holding on to the word. So Timothy held on to the word. He was surrendered. And so why did Paul pick him? Because he was. He held on to the word. And that's what Paul said. Paul said, I noticed something about you. The word that you receive, you held on to it. Now, I can go into the youth room right now, and there's some kids that if I looked at them, I would say, hey, bro, it looks like you dropped the word. You're not holding on to it. So instead of being well spoken of, you've got a lot of hell in your life. And what's that a result of? Oh, well, my family and this and that. What is that a result of? You didn't surrender. You didn't hold on to the word. Look what Paul goes on to say. He says this. He said, therefore, I remind you, stir up the gift of God, which is in you. That means remind yourself. Go over these things and over these things. Go in your Bibles really quick to 2 Timothy 3:14. One page over. Look what he told him. Continue. Say, continue. Continue in the things which you have learned. Surrender isn't just, God, I surrender to you once. It's like a constant surrender. When temptation tries to come, what do you hold on to? When fear tries to come, yeah, you hold on to that. When temptation to disobey comes, what do you hold on to?
Down flesh.
Down flesh. Ephesians 6:1. What does it say? Children.
Obey
your parents in the Lord, for this is right, right? Whenever a show comes on or something that your flesh wants to watch, what should you? Should you drop that and take up that? No. What do you hold on to? Proverbs 23:4, what does it say?
Guard
your heart with diligence. See, if you don't hold on to the word, holding on to the word, that's surrender. Surrender is holding on to the word. So whenever I surrender, I hold on to the word and I don't let go. Paul told Timothy, continue. Y'all, why was Timothy chosen?
Because he was surrendered.
And here's the thing. Y'all, we should crave, we should desire. The Bible even says desire or covet spiritual gifts. Like you want to be able to do everything that God has called you to do. You should want that. You know why? Because that's actually going to make your life better. Wanting to be a certain size, wanting to have a certain talent, wanting to have status, that's not going to make your life better.
Right.
Being an amazing football player, guess what?
It's
not going to make your life better. But wanting what God has for your life, that literally sets you up to be above anything that the world tries to do. Anything. Like, it makes you the best. But you have to choose. God, I'm going to surrender. See, Timothy, he surrendered. He walked away from his plan. Even at one point, Paul was like, hey, bro, you need to get circumcised. And he was a grown boy. If you don't know what circumcision is, you can ask your parents. But it hurts. It's like surgery, major surgery. Like, you need to get this done, because if you don't, then people are going to question. It wasn't absolutely necessary. But what Timothy was like, I'll do whatever. I'll do whatever. I'll do whatever. I want to glorify God in my body. I want to glorify God in my thoughts. I want to glorify God in my words. He lived a surrendered life. But what did he have to do? He had to hold on to the word. Paul said, I noticed something about you. I notice that you're holding on to what's been passed to you. You know, some of you were able to say a scripture that you're holding on to. But what about when temptation comes? What about when fear tries to come? You need to have a word that you're holding on to. Now, have you received a lot of word here at church?
Yes.
Yes. Do you have access to a lot of word every time you sit down for a quiet time?
Yes.
Yes. So do we have any excuse?
No.
No. What's the only reason why believers, or at least believers at this church, walk away and don't do what God's called them to do? They didn't surrender. They didn't hold on to the word. Y'all, I can't hold on to the word for you. As much as I would want to hold on to the word for young people, I can't do it for you. Guess who I have to do it for?
Yourself.
I have to do it for me. So guess who you have to do it for?
Me.
You got to hold on to the word. And when you hold on to the word, what happens?
You surrender
and you do what God's called you to do.
Right.
Y'all, because at the end of your life, like, you're literally going to stand before him. And he's going to say, hey, bro, I called you to do this. And you were too busy playing games and acting like you knew what you were supposed to do. And all you had to do was surrender. You're going to stand before him. That's going to be a real thing. Look to your neighbor and say, stuff's going to get real. And listen, it's going to be too late for you to backtrack and say, well. No, he's seen it. So now I have an opportunity. What do I need to do? What word do I need to hold on to? At school, are you screwing around? Are you jacking around? Because the word says to do everything you do as unto the Lord. So if Jesus was in the room, how would Jesus act? When you're around your group of friends, if you don't normally say stuff and normally do things that you wouldn't do if your parent or Pastor Kathy or myself wasn't there, do you think it's well spoken of you?
No.
And y'all, we want that. Say, I want that.
I want that.
I don't want to be different everywhere I go. That's fake. That's ugly. And that's not God. That's actually the enemy. The Bible says that he transforms himself into a person of light. He's the one that's shady. Every time I'm shady, who am I acting like?
The devil
himself. So I'm not going to do it. I'm going to be the same. And that being the same is being who I'm called to be, holding on to the word and surrendering, just like Timothy.